aspirin. It's one of the most commonly used drugs in the world. It might be one of, if not the oldest drug in the world too, because it comes from nature. Plants, in fact, the willow tree and the meadowsweet. Meadowsweet, by the way, is called spiraea. Chuck an acetal on the beginning of that and drug it up with an in on the end, and hey, you got it. Now, this is part of a series of videos I'm making to help you understand the drugs that you're taking, because it turns out that quite often we don't really know what we're putting in our mouths. I'll cover why we need it, how it works, the side effects, and then I normally say stick around if you're really geeky and want the history or the pharmacology, but today I'm going to say please do stick around, because the history is really interesting and I guarantee at least 2 pub quiz winners off the back of it. The pharmacology, on the other hand, is probably a bit like whoosh, but it might be good for you aspiring scientists. Please do stay watching if you want more hilarious jokes. Why do you need it? Well, it's a painkiller, the third one in this series. Turns out humans have quite a lot of pain. Now, it's a simple one, which means it's low down the painkiller ladder, and it's technically in the same drug class as ibuprofen. That is to say, it's a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, or NSAID. However, it also has a pretty cool secondary function which the other drugs don't have. It has an anti-platelet effect, platelets being the things that help you clot. So you might be taking it for 2 reasons. One, as a painkiller and an anti-fever agent, normally in a pretty whacking dose, sometimes up to 4 grams per day, and that's something where you might self-medicate. I mean, you can get aspirin over the counter. And 2, as an anti-platelet drug, which is really useful if we think you've had a heart attack or a stroke, and in the secondary prevention of cardiovascular disease, which means we're trying to stop you having another heart attack or stroke. And you might have heard of that as baby aspirin, which is in the UK, that's about 75 milligrams. Now, normally when we're talking about this kind of thing, your doctor is prescribing it, but a lot of people, especially middle-aged upwards, take a baby aspirin off their own back, and that's something I'll talk more about over the course of this video. It's a bit nuanced and actually probably not the best thing to do for the majority of people, so stay tuned. Now, there's actually a third reason, which is more for the end of this video, because it's pretty complicated stuff, but there is ongoing research that it may, and I really need to stress may, because it also may not, help to reduce the risk of getting or the complications of colorectal cancer. So keep watching to the end to find out more. Aspirin is a tablet that you swallow, but it can also be chewable or dispersible, so it can dissolve in water, which is especially useful if you're gargling because you've got a nasty sore throat. It's easy to get and it's pretty safe for most people, but for a number of reasons, which we'll find out why in a second, we tend to prefer people having ibuprofen or paracetamol as their painkiller of choice. How does it work? Well, let's split things into 2 camps: the painkilling and the antiplatelets. Now, the painkilling is something we've actually already covered. It's the same as ibuprofen, so it blocks an enzyme called a COX enzyme, which stops the production of prostaglandins, and prostaglandins go on to cause pain, they cause swelling, they cause fever, so if you block them, you get the desired effect. However, when it comes to aspirin, lowish doses will reduce pain and reduce fever, but it won't reduce swelling until it's in a higher dose. Now, if you want to find out about prostaglandins and painkillers, I recommend you go and watch that video up there where I cover things in a lot more detail. Here though, let's get into the anti-platelet effect, because in honesty, that's the main reason that people are probably taking it these days. So a big difference between aspirin and other NSAIDs is that aspirin blocks the COX enzyme permanently. The other ones block them competitively and temporarily, so just keep that in mind for later. Now, when you get sliced or you cut yourself, your blood vessels break, and that exposes the stuff that's in the walls of your blood vessel to your blood. Your platelets go, let's go! And they get to action to form a clot. Now, that clot forms in a really complicated way, so I'm not going to go into too much detail, but what you need to know is that platelets are key. So when platelets find a problem, they go, let's go, and they activate. A single activated platelet can do a lot of things, but one thing it can't do is sort a clot by itself. It needs its friends. It releases a bunch of chemicals, one is called thromboxane A2, which then recruit a bunch of other platelets, which together form a clot. Let's go! Oh, actually, let's not go, because we've taken aspirin. So thromboxane is produced through an action of the COX enzyme. So if you block the COX enzyme, you stop thromboxane being produced, which means platelets can't call their mates, and you don't form a clot. All NSAIDs will do this, but remember, only aspirin is permanent. So whereas ibuprofen, for example, will block platelets and then get washed away pretty fast, aspirin is permanent, which means the platelets can't call its friends for the rest of its life. Platelets live about 8 to 10 days, you replace about 10% of them every day. So if you're thinking about stopping clots forming, for example, just after a heart attack, then taking a decent dose of aspirin will make it pretty hard for clots to form. If you take it every day, that continues. In the UK, aspirin is taken lifelong after a heart attack, and that's why aspirin is called an anti-platelet drug. We're stopping clots, right? But if you stop clots, what do you get? Bleeding. And although this isn't anywhere near the most common side effect people get when taking aspirin, it's the one we need to think about the most because this is an anti-platelet drug and because you might be on it for life. Now, you might bruise a bit more easily than before. If you bite your tongue, it might bleed a tiny bit longer. But for every 1,000 people who take low-dose aspirin, one or two of them will have a major hemorrhagic event, be that a gastrointestinal bleed or a bleed on the brain. That risk increases with age and with diabetes. But medicine is about balance of risk and benefit. Now, if you've had a heart attack, the benefit of taking aspirin to stop you having another one greatly outweighs the risk of you having a major bleed. However, if you haven't had something like a heart attack and you're taking a baby aspirin because you think it might be good for your health, and maybe even prevent something nasty happening later, then the risk-benefit calculation kind of goes the other way. And although it probably does reduce your risk, the majority of medical professionals would argue that the risk isn't worth taking. You'll have a much better health trajectory from simply just improving your lifestyle. Now that is aspirin for life. You don't have to consider that risk if you're just taking aspirin for a headache. I should also point out that aspirin is an anti-platelet drug. It's not an anticoagulant. Those are drugs like warfarin, rivaroxaban, apixaban. Those are really bleedy drugs. Now, aspirin isn't because platelets are only one small part of your huge clotting cascade and can still be activated in other ways. So if you Google this kind of thing, just make sure you've made that distinction. Other side effects are similar to other NSAIDs. Prostaglandins work all over your body, so when you stop them being produced, you might run into issues in those places. The most common one in your stomach, where you produce less protective mucus, so you might get more stomach discomfort or heartburn. If you're on it long term, you might get gastric ulcers. It's also not so good if you're asthmatic, have kidney problems, and it can cause you to have a runny nose. One thing we don't do, however, is give aspirin to kids. There's a very rare but extremely serious condition called Reye's syndrome, and that only really affects children. And when you use aspirin to treat a fever and a viral infection, it can contribute to it. It's exceedingly rare, but just don't give aspirin to kids unless your doctor has prescribed it especially. As always, if you don't feel right when you're taking a drug or you're wondering whether aspirin is right for you, just talk to your doctor. And if you're enjoying this content, please do give me a like and a subscribe and do share it around because you know what? It really, really does help. Aspirin is the best known drug in the world. Why? Because it's been around for 3,500 years. Well, not aspirin per se, but the thing that it comes from, the willow tree. Yep, the journey for aspirin starts in this thing over there because it's in the bark and to a lesser extent the leaves that you get a sugary molecule called salicin. And when you eat that, your body breaks it down and you release sugar and you release salicyl alcohol, which then gets turned into salicylic acid. And salicylic acid is a thing that gets rid of pain. And so effective that it's been used for thousands of years, and some people even still use it today as a traditional remedy. The records go back, and I kid you not, at least 3,500 years. Obviously, the Sumerians and the Egyptians didn't know what the active ingredient was, but they did know that willow bark was a good painkiller. Edwin Smith was an American trader living in Cairo in the 19th century, and he purchased a pair of ancient papyri, which turned out to be medical papyri dating back to 1500 BC. These are now called the Edwin Smith Papyrus and the Ebers Papyrus, and they're full of useful surgical cases and herbal remedies, and it's here that you get the first written record of willow being used to treat non-specific pains. 1,000 years later, Hippocrates, the father of medicine, and Galen, the prince of physicians, used willow bark to relieve inflammatory pain and the pain of childbirth. A couple of hundred years after that, Pliny the Elder reported the use of willow as an analgesic and an antipyretic in his seminal work, Natural History. Since then, throughout time, you're seeing the use of willow be used in medicine all over the world, from indigenous South African Hottentots to Native Americans. as wars took off and as we conquered the seas and the Western world and China started to put together more concoctions from more plants and more animals, the willow tree was always high up the list. But other plants which also contained salicin, like the meadow sweet, were being used as well for everything from rheumatism to wounds to ulcers to headaches to period pain. But we now need to turn this tree into this drug. And that starts in the 18th century. Reverend Edward Stone from Chipping Norton, just down the road from Jeremy Clarkson's farm.
Oh, fucking hell!
Used willow bark extracts to treat pain, but did it in a very scientific way, giving it every 4 hours and monitoring what happened. He left the bark on a baker's oven for 3 months and then pounded it into powder. He reported,
"It hath been given, I believe, to 50 persons and never failed in the cure, except in a few autumnal and quartern agues with which the patient have been long and feverly afflicted."
This kind of scientific rigour leads you down a path for others to start to extract the active ingredient. And in 1820s, two Italian pharmacists and a German pharmacologist did just that. This ingredient was called salicin, named after Salix, the genus of the willow tree. Over time, scientists refined that to salicylic acid. Now, although we knew that salicin and salicylic acid helped with pain, it did cause other side effects like tinnitus, nausea, gastritis. So further refinement was required, and Stepin Pharmaceutical Research Group, Bayer, still going today and pretty big, who hoped that the right chemical formula, a fortune could be made. The team was led by Carl Duisberg, who was a radical mind keen to tweak drugs to perfection. He hired some lieutenants, a head of chemistry research called Arthur Eichengrün and a head of pharmacology called Heinrich Dresser. In general, organic compounds produced by plants are complex and difficult to manipulate, but with salicylates you're in luck because they're pretty simple molecules. Eichengrün was interested in acetal groups, that is a small molecule with two carbon atoms that can be attached to something. He instructed his junior, Felix Hoffmann, to whack acetal groups on the two most promising drugs of the time, salicylic acid from the meadowsweet and morphine from the poppy. This produced acetyl salicylic acid, which would be known one day as aspirin, and diamorphine, known one day as heroin. Now, Dresser, the head of pharmacology, decided to pursue one of them only, and he chose heroin, which I'm sure you'll agree turned out pretty well. But Eichengrün couldn't stomach this and went behind his boss's back, running human trials in Berlin on unsuspecting dental patients. Yeah, ethics were not a thing back then. But you know what? The feedback was pretty good. One patient reportedly jumped up saying his toothache was completely gone.
No pain, no pain, no pain. No pain.
Crucially, the side effects were not being reported. When Eichengrün eventually told Dresser what he'd done, Dresser was obviously not impressed. He dismissed Eichengrün and wrote, "This is the usual loud mouthing of Berlin. The product has no value." He continued to push heroin. Eventually though, the main boss man, Duisberg, intervened, saw the merit and moved forward with both drugs. In 1899, the commercial name for the drug was selected, aspirin. A for acetal, spirea for the meadowsweet's Latin name, and then the standard drug suffix in, which makes drugs easier to pronounce across Europe. It had a slow uptake at first, but then in 1918, the Spanish flu pandemic spread around the world and killed 50 million people. Now, although aspirin didn't cure anyone, it did relieve a lot of the symptoms and help reduce mortality, and it exploded in popularity from then. Today, more than 70 million tablets, or 35,000 tons, are sold every year. That's the same weight as three Eiffel Towers. The use has slowly decreased over time because other painkillers are more stable and have a better profile and don't cause issues in kids, something which was discovered in the 60s. Drugs like paracetamol and ibuprofen have knocked this painkiller off its perch, but it has grown in popularity as an anti-platelet, a journey which is laid in stone when the Nobel Prize in 1982 was won by John Vane, Bent Samuelson and Sune Bergstrom for discovering how aspirin actually works by discovering prostaglandins, thromboxane and the COX enzymes. Today, many history books attribute the discovery of aspirin to Felix Hoffmann, Eichengrün's junior. But in truth, he was only a very minor character, adding an acetal group without really knowing what he was synthesizing. And for that, you can blame the Nazis. Bayer didn't publish the discovery of aspirin until the 1930s. The delay was in large part due to Dresser, who never forgave Eichengrün for going behind his back. He blocked it and tried to omit him for some time. Unfortunately, by the time it did get through, the Nazi party was in power and Aryan ideals were a requisite of history. even though Eichengreen had become a prominent industrialist running his own chemical company at this time. He was also a Jew. He was interned in a concentration camp and struck from the record books. And so even if you Google it now, you often get the sanitized version that Felix Hoffmann invented the drug to help his ailing father, and his brilliant discovery was recognized by Bayer, who shared it all over the world. But in reality, a vindictive middle manager preferred the commercial prospects of heroin over aspirin, and the company who owned it bent history to the anti-Semitic ideals of early 20th century Germany. If you've seen my ibuprofen video, you'll have seen the arachidonic acid pathway before, and you'll see that ibuprofen interacts with the cyclooxygenase, or COX, enzymes. There are two of these, COX-1 and COX-2. Aspirin does the same thing, except it incapacitates these enzymes permanently. Both enzymes are involved in the synthesis of prostaglandins, which are hormone-like substances that play a key role in inflammation, pain, and fever. COX-1 is constitutively expressed in many tissues, including the GI tract, kidneys, and platelets, and it produces prostaglandins, which are important for the normal physiological functions, such as maintaining the integrity of the GI lining, regulating blood flow to the kidneys, and here's a key one, promoting platelet aggregation through the formation of thromboxane A2. COX-2, on the other hand, is induced in response to inflammatory stimuli and produces prostaglandins that mediate pain, fever, and inflammation. Aspirin blocks both enzymes, but it blocks COX-1 a lot easier than it blocks COX-2. This is because of a number of complicated biochemical things, including the high peroxide tone of cells, which go on to cause pain. That's why you need a low dose to block platelets, but you need a much higher dose to overwhelm the COX-2 and therefore have an anti-inflammatory and analgesic effect. Once it's absorbed in the stomach and in the upper intestine, it works pretty quick and has an anti-platelet effect within an hour. Now, I did mention at the beginning that I talk very briefly about colorectal cancer. During the past 10 years, some long-term randomized trials have demonstrated that low-dose aspirin reduces the incidence and mortality of colorectal cancer after a delay of 8 to 10 years. The mechanisms are still being explored. Now, it may have something to do with COX-2 activity in the GI tract. As I mentioned, platelets produce a bunch of mediators like thromboxane. It also produces a prostaglandin called PGE2, which may help to create an environment for intestinal neoplasia or cancer. So taking aspirin blocks both COX enzymes and also reduces the activity of platelets. The science is really quite complicated, and you can read about it in the links I've put below. Ultimately, the research is ongoing, and it's exciting to see where it all might lead. So that's aspirin, the oldest drug known to mankind, derived from the willow tree, developed over generations, and still surprising us to this day. Plenty of other drug explainers on this channel, and loads of other fun things too. So please take a look if you haven't already. Do subscribe, it does help. Take care, stay healthy, and I'll see you next time.